my dear, dear friends, my church family, in the best and most meaningful sense of the word. The Lord be with you and with your spirit this afternoon. Let us approach the supernal in the way that we think is most appropriate and best. And this is Valentine's Hall. Our patron is Saint Valentine. We won't be here too, sadly, to celebrate the mysteries of Saint Valentine, closer to Valentine's Day. But it's a time when we remember lovers, we remember love, we remember unconditional compassion. And it's a time when we remember that some people think the teachings of the Gnostic Valentinus are actually hidden within that story and his teachings. And either way, on one level, it doesn't matter, because having a deep intuition of love and wisdom is never a bad thing in anyone's path. Let us approach the altar to praise and worship. There is no life that is not in community, and no community not lived in praise of God. I am very honoured and proud to say we have a truly ecumenical attitude. We welcome our dear Muslim brothers and sisters, we welcome our Jewish brothers and sisters, we welcome our pagan, our heathen brothers and sisters, who I personally think embody the indigenous Old Testament of this part of the world. That doesn't mean we ignore the Jewish Old Testament, it means we add our own experience and spirituality into that act of worship, which I think in this day and age is very, very important. As usual, we don't have all the codes, you'll have to forgive us. We will be moaning about that. This is probably the last service which is so small. I'm going to put the thumb screws on people from next month and say, look, let's be a bit more robust. I mean, let's have a longer time of worship. Let's have some real fellowship. Let's have a bun fight and really get into it a bit more prudently and get the screen working properly and get the music system working properly. So at the moment, we can't test that sadly, but we can hear some music to put us in the mood. From my humble mobile, take a few minutes of silence and enjoy the music. We are here in the spirit of Jesus Christ. We are here because we are human. But we deny our humanity too often. We are stubborn fools and liars to ourselves. We do not love others. We war against life. We hurt each other, and we are sorry for it, and we know that we are sick from it. We seek a new life. O giver of life, heal us and free us to be fully human. Holy Spirit, speak to us. Help us to listen, for we are very deaf. Come, fill this moment and this afternoon with your presence. Amen. Can a woman forget the infant at her breast? Or a mother the child of her womb? As a mother comforts her child, so will I comfort you, says the Lord. My friends, there are many weaknesses and misdemeanors within ourselves and in those around us. Let's think of wholeness and integrity and a better road ahead. That's really one of the main points of a service such as this. To assert family, to assert friendship, and to help each other along the way. Now, since this is a reduced service because of the present restrictions, I think you all know my view of the present restrictions, so I'm not going to go on about it this afternoon. What we are going to do, however, is get into our time of readings, and we'll start with my wonderful actress friend, Jerry Skins, who will take the floor and wow us all with a number of numbers.
Good afternoon, everybody. I don't know about wowing you. I'm going to read a short extract from the end of a book called The Master and Margarita, which is by the Russian author Mikhail Bulgakov, who was a doctor during the Stalin's time. Well, actually, it was during Stalin's time. And he wrote this book, which in short is When the Devil Makes a Personal Appearance in Moscow. His retinue includes two demons, a naked girl and a huge black cat, which talks and walks upright, smokes cigars, and is a dead shot with a Mauser automatic. Some of the devil's pranks are sheer anarchic fun. More often, they are chosen to bring out the worst in everybody. When he leaves Moscow, the asylums are full, the forces of law and order are in disarray, and the population is haunted with deep feelings of guilt and shame. This is also a love story, because amid the bizarre pantomime, there remains undiminished two characters, the master and his great love, Margarita. The master is a man single-mindedly devoted to the search for truth and has poured the skills of a lifetime into a book which is the reinterpretation of the trial and death of Christ. I'm now going to read you a short passage from the end of this really quite remarkable book, which has many, many layers. The black Voland said, "Farewell, I must go." "Farewell," cried Margarita and the master together. And then the black Voland, taking none of the paths, dived into the abyss, followed with a roar by his retinue. The mountains, the platform, the moonbeam pathway, Jerusalem, all were gone. The black horses, too, had vanished. The master and Margarita saw the promised dawn, which rose in instant succession to the midnight moon. In the first rays of the morning, the master and his beloved crossed a little moss-grown stone bridge. "Listen to the silence," said Margarita to the master, the sand rustling under her bare feet. "Listen to the silence and enjoy it. Here is the peace that you never knew in your lifetime. Look, there is your home for eternity, which is your reward. I can already see a Venetian window and a climbing vine which grows right up into the roof. It is your home forever. In the evenings, people will come to see you, people who interest you, people who will never upset you. They will play to you and sing to you, and you will see how beautiful the room is by candlelight. Sleep will give you strength and make you wise, and you can never send me away. I shall watch over your sleep." So said Margarita as she walked with the master towards their everlasting home, and her words seemed to him to flow like the whispering stream behind them. And the master's accursed, needling memory began to fade. He had been freed. On the night of Sunday, the day of the resurrection, pardon had been granted to the astrologer's son, fifth procurator of Judea, and the cruel Pontius Pilate. Back in Moscow, educated and cultured people, of course, took no part at all in the gossip about evil spirits descending on Moscow, and even laughed at those who did and tried to bring them to reason. But facts, as they say, are facts, and they could not be brushed aside without some explanation. Someone had come to Moscow. The few charred cinders of buildings, and much more besides, were proof of that. The man calling himself Woland and his followers had vanished from Moscow, never to return there or anywhere else. He was, of course, suspected of having escaped abroad, but there was no sign of his being there either.
The joy of reading that masterpiece, I strongly suggest it. I did say a number of years ago that literature was also a part of my religion. Every time that is read to me, I remember why I said that.
It is the most extraordinary.
It's the most extraordinary piece of work. I strongly recommend it if you want some deep insights, not only into literature, but the human condition itself. We are a metropolitan community church in ACES. We are also part of a growing part of the Congregational Federation, and there will be more about that. There will be further announcements about that in the year ahead. I personally, as a humble pastor, so said, as most of you know, have a very strong Unitarian attitude in my theology. All religions are true, but some have access to the transcendent more than others, and we can argue about that and discuss that in the weeks ahead. I suppose Unitarianism, as it came to this part of the world, debatably, directly from Judea, debatably, looked in the early centuries at the humanity of Christ, whatever that might mean, and the full divinity of God, of course, that later became Islam. So we're looking at an ancient continuum here with a very, very hospitable nature. I can't think of any Unitarian colleague of mine in the past, or for that matter a Congregationalist, who wouldn't welcome my friend Stead Steadman, who is a Godie, and the acting Godie of the London...
Bloat.
Of the London Bloat. Yeah. Over 10 told me different. Yeah, but I thought that's what it was called. I am determined that we build not only some Islamic elements into this in the months ahead, but I think it's fitting that Stead has a liturgical space and a window during our Old Testament time. Stead, please guide us through your book.
Okay. I'm going to conduct a micro-bloat, which should last about 10 minutes, so it's a compression of what would normally take place and perhaps last an hour, hour and a half. I'm going to start with the first verse of Balham and call for a moment of silence. I shall light the candle and then proceed with a few readings, invocations, in particular to Goddess Skadi, who this float is dedicated to and is represented by the image on the altar. I should say something about her, and I would consecrate me also onto a small piece of earth. Both in herself and in her relation with Njord, her husband, as we are talking about couples and love between different people, different beings. In herself, She's a striking and strong image of virtue, which I think we should think of emulating. She thrives in the adversity of cold, which is very appropriate today, and she thrives by her skills, by the accuracy of her bow. She's a huntress, and the stealth and assiduity with which she tracks down her kinesis alive. Her being in its simplicity is as pure as the snow with which she skis. And skiing is such a state of speed and liberation that I think it's a fitting metaphor for those happy times in one's life when one is moving forward effortlessly and in an intensified and blissful state of freedom. As is well known, I think, but perhaps not here, Scully got to choose a husband in reparation for the slaying of her father, Thiadsi, by the gods, and she had to make the choice from looking only at the feet and lower legs of the Ceres suitors. And it was Lord Njord, the god she chose, and he's certainly god of the sea, but he's also god of the fertility of the earth and the wealth it offers. That's to say, he's also inherently god of the summer. And together, the couple represent the totality of the year's seasons, she being the god of winter, he of summer. And it's quite a nice, rather sort of ancient engraving here, and one can see them. And that's quite nice, because they're together in a circle. And there's a sense in which wherever they are is whatever the time of the year it is. They're either going towards Trimheim, where she lives, that's to say towards the winter solstice, or back to Noatum, where he lives. The pantheon of deities above is made up, like society below, of couples for the most part, but not rigidly so. And I think this is true of all authentic revelations in Hindu Dharma. One finds, for example, secrets of couples, Saraswati Brahma, Lakshmi Vishnu, Shiva Shakti, Mother Krishna, Sita Ram, but also Hanumanji, who is given as an example of the ideal celibate, and similarly with the Lord Swaminarayan. And I shall offer salutations to five divine couples in North Pantheon in a moment. And this is part of the normal block, just to dedicate oneself to the act of worship. Let us dedicate ourselves to the gods of our peoples and lands, making this offering in friendship with one another, leaving disputes and weapon outside the blade and sacred space we're about to enter into. Let us turn in piety and contrition to the gods we once turned our backs upon. May you be free of any impediment now, this is a heart of service from your presence, receptive to whatever truth or counsel it may be given to us to understand in the course of this work and after this day. Blessed are the here, see not previously, blessed are the free gold, see not previously, blessed are the known and bonded, see not previously, blessed are the toy of toy, see not previously, blessed are the sick, or see not previously, blessed are the scout up here, see not previously, blessed are the healing, see not previously, blessed are the bulls, see not previously, blessed are the hind ones, see not previously, or all. May indeed there be a blessing for us. Right, bride of gods, show us the target, and on the swift skis, Through the snow, through it take us, as arrows from your quiver, shoot the highest target with us. Sharp, straight, obedient, and purified, our purpose is by that. Shining ski goddess, bright bride of gods, scarlet. Jerry, if you could read the extract from Gnostic.
Okay, the last one. Concerning Njord and Skadi. The third god is the one who is called Njord. He lives in heaven, in that place named Noatung. He rules the course of wind and still sea and fire. One calls upon him in seafaring and in fishing. He is so rich and wealthy that he can give to those who call upon him the riches of land and valuable things. Njord is not of the race of Aesir. He was brought up in Vanaheim, but the Vanir offered him as hostage to the gods, to the Aesir, in their war with the Vanir, and took in return the one who is named Hinir. He brought about reconciliation between Aesir and the Vanir. Njord has a wife who is named Skadi, the daughter of Tharzi, the Jotun giant. Skadi wants to have that abode which her father had, which is atop the mountains and is named Thrymheim, but Njord wants to be near the sea. They became reconciled upon this, that they should be 9 nights in Thrymheim and then another 9 at Noatun. But when Njord came back to Noatun from the mountain, he declared, "Loathed are the mountains to me, where no more than 9 nights I was. The wailing of the wolves seemed foul to me after the song of the swans." Then declared Skadi, "Sleep I could not on the seabeds because of the screaming of the birds. That gull coming from the sea wakes me every morning." Then Skadi travelled up to the mountain and lived at Thrymheim, and she travels a lot on skis and with a bow and shoots animals. She is named Ski Deity or Ski Lady. Thus it is said, Thrymheim it is called where Tharzi lived, that great mighty Jotun, but now Skadi lives in the dwelling of her father, the bright bride of God.
What is the moral of this? That the god and the goddess had that complementarity, which is one of the basis for attraction and for having happy union. But they seem to possess it, I think, in excess to a degree that prevented their living together in one place. The other basis for a happy relationship is, of course, commonality, which they seem to possess too little of, perhaps, to keep together. But they are deities, and they have a responsibility to their domains. For lesser beings like us, I think the moral is that we need to be able to accustom ourselves to, and even get to like, both the howling of the wolves and the screaming of the sea. Grace of the gods, he was created in their image and assumed its powers, and by their grace to them we shall. Ever for, speaketh here, let us walk. This is ever for. Gods of our peoples and lands, in gratitude for every meal we've enjoyed, every roof over our heads, every day we've seen break and set, every breath we've drawn, and every beat of our heart. We partake of the meal of the bonding spirit, blood and soul between you and us, between us and the earth, both here and across the world, and across the worlds we find. Hail, Lady of the Mountains, goddess of places high and lofty, estates elevate and from the flat exalted, and to the rarity of Asgard closer brought. Whence a right view of where we lowly live, a vision vouchsafes of what we might otherwise be. O brave and quick, hardy and skilled of hand, hunting down food to feed our growth, speeding across the snow, still with taunt bow and straight arrow aiming, shooting and finding, the glory of action to a purpose, without the ugly fat of the unnecessary. Grant a sight of your beauty, lady, that we may raise ourselves to follow it. Swift, shiny, shooting scar. Blotting, locking.
The wisdom of our ancestors and remembering the lofty nature of some of our ancestors that were touched with divinity. Some of us here, of course, believe that the divinity of divinities is one, that behind every layer and level of creation there is one ultimate divine reality. And that's also something I look forward to discussing in the months ahead. Which leads us to the Hebrew old reading. Old Testament reading. Dan, which one did we agree on?
Samuel.
Right, and also the love poem?
Yeah.
So Dan will now read a love poem and then move on to the Hebrew Old Testament.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure and honour to be here, brothers and sisters. I've got a very brief paragraph from the first book of Samuel, and the reason why I thought this would be relevant was because, you know, as a Metropolitan Community Church Oasis group, an LGBT friendly church group and community, I thought, you know, this verse, this paragraph in the Old Testament was particularly relevant because it's the story of Jonathan and David, who were LGBT characters in the Bible. Okay. When he had finished speaking to Saul, the soul of Jonathan was knit to the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. And Saul took him that day and would not let him return to his father's house. Then Jonathan made a covenant with David, because he loved him as his own soul. And Jonathan stripped himself of the robe that was upon him, and gave it to David, and his armor, and even his sword, and his bow, and his girdle. And David went out and was successful wherever Saul sent him, so that Saul set him over the men of war, and this was good in the sight of all the people, and also in the sight of Saul's servants. So I think that's just a very good example of how you can see
the heart of Scripture.
In the heart of Scripture. The other reading I was going to do today was by Shakespeare, a very brief poem, very famous poem by Shakespeare. And as you most certainly will know, Shakespeare was an LGBT playwright, writer, actor. So let's remember that as well. William Shakespeare. Shall I compare thee to a summer's day? Thou art more lovely and more temperate. Rough winds do shake the darling buds of May, and summer's leaves have all too short a date. Sometime too hot the eye of heaven shines, and often is his gold complexion dimmed. and every fair from fair sometime declines, by chance or nature's changing course untrimmed. But thy eternal summer shall not fade, nor lose possession of that fair thou owest, nor shall death grab thou, wanderest in his shade, when in eternal lines to time thou growest. So long as men can breathe, or eyes can see, so long lives this, and this gives life to thee.
The risk of introducing a little levity into our proceedings. I remember I went to a very series of postules. I apologise for that. I remember an argument breaking out one afternoon with the teacher saying, "I know what it looks like and sounds like, but it's not." And us all saying, "It says very clearly there, sonnets to Mr. X. Right, we're moving on, turn the page." So, I mean, it is in black and white. But, you know, things like that don't happen in schools anymore. Nobody reads Shakespeare. What a terrible shame. I mean, what are they missing? Anyway, our Old Testament readings are not to be minimised, they're not to be relativised, they're not to be pushed into the sidelines. They are part of the stories of what we are. Before love can become transcendent, we need to know a lot more of our own stories, our own histories, our own cultures, all of which some of us believe raise a great hymn to realms unknown. And it's that realm now we begin to approach. Who shall separate us from the love of love, the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No. In all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For we are convinced that neither death nor life nor angels nor rulers nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Please take a few minutes in the silence of your own hearts to remember your own needs and the needs of those that you love before we get to the end of this part of our service. I don't know what you're praying for, but I will say on heaven to help you to get those prayers done. Creator of all, lead us and every people into ways of justice and peace, that we may respect one another in freedom and truth. Awaken us a sense of wonder, each one of us, for the earth and all that is in it. Teach us to care creatively for our resources, our friends, our kinsfolk. We'll now have another musical interlude before we come to the break one.
Thank you.
I said previously, we are very proudly a Metropolitan Community Church oasis. And if anyone in the fellowship is watching, I apologise in advance for slightly experimenting with liturgy today. Before we approach the table, I'm already meant to have read from the New Testament, but I couldn't when I realised what the most appropriate reading from John was today. Hold back from that reading a bit before I invite you. This is a reading from 1 John 4, and it sort of sums up what we're looking at today. We're remembering lovers across the world today, of all different types and all natures. We're remembering those that are in love, and that is a sacred human feeling and must never be diminished or minimised. And we're also remembering unconditional love. That step may be beyond that. That step may be complementary to that. And certainly the saint is struggling with those thoughts in this verse. Beloved, let us love one another. For love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not hath not known God, for God is love. Herein the love of God was manifested towards us, that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, that he might live through him. Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us, and sent his Son to be a propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God loved so much each of us, we also ought to love one another. No man hath seen God at any time. If we love one another, however, God abideth in us, and in the love of him, it is perfected in us. That, for me, is one of the clarion calls of a revolutionary denomination like Metropolitan Community Church. It was part of the civil rights movements. It's still part of the cutting edge in all of those advances of the human conditions, those necessary arguments that hopefully may one day bring us into a better world. Shying away from the arguments is the problem, and not engaging with them is the problem, and not being honest with them is the problem. I didn't feel it was appropriate to have a sermon today because our time here is too short, but I just want to say the Metropolitan Community Church alone has supported these rather experimental liturgies, and we're very, very proud that it's given us the freedom to genuinely look for love and wisdom in all of its forms, which is what I intend to do more fearlessly with your permission in the months ahead. Another thing Metropolitan Community Church is very good at is the table. A service of worship in the Christian tradition is normally divided into four parts, four great segments. The greeting, the ministry of the word, the ministry of the table, and then the blessing of departure. Sadly, in many churches, to approach a table that belongs to Christ, not that particular church, means they have rules and regulations and strictures. But this is the table of Christ. It does not belong to any particular church. You can approach it freely, no matter what your background is, your faith, your lack of faith. No matter where you stand, you are welcome if you feel this will benefit you in your spiritual life and your path ahead. Because of COVID-19 restrictions and our respect for the Kalos Centre, I will actually bring the bread and the wine to all of you, because we don't want to upset our wonderful hosts. Instead, it's so wonderful having you here, but please don't worry about that in the least. It's wonderful. And I notice you've broke your leg. I hope that's not snow slipping off anything. No, I mean, what I want us to do is approach light in the realest way imaginable. I'll tell you a scary, wonderful story before I serve the bread and the wine. As a Hampshire hog, I mean, like everybody else in Britain, I'm bits of things. I'm mixed. I've got German somewhere, I've got Italian, I've got Welsh, I've got Irish, you know, bits of things. I think it's very, very pretty. I went to school in Portsmouth in Hampshire. There was a minister who was giving out light. No one was quite sure what he was doing, but what he was managing to affect was noticeable. In the communion, something would happen each month, and people started having the most bizarre of experiences. Golden bodies appearing outside tenement blocks. All sorts of unusual and wonderful things. Yeah. For the minister, he would only say, "I'm giving out light." None of us knew what that meant to school children, but it's intriguing. Let me tell you what happens when somebody is actually doing that. The police visited the church and closed it down. Isn't that a gospel tale, if ever there was? So, but to respect the rules and the guidelines of our hosts and love to them, I will now bring you the bread and the wine. Please don't feel you have to take it. It's not an act of magic, it's an act of communion, it's an act of memory. Right, and it's not specific, I would argue, to a particular religious tradition. What makes us more human than sharing a meal together? What makes it more holy than the staff of life that has kept innumerable generations fed and a little wine to help thy digestion? What could be more human and therefore more holy than this type of commemoration? I'll approach you all. Jerry, if you'd like to take some bread, because this is how we remember that glorious transcendent part of ourselves.
Do you want music?
Ahmed? I'm sure the prophet is smiling on you. I think right, my friends, remembering the light and the higher things within ourselves. Now, this turned into a disaster last time, so we're trying to do two cards. I think it got Shiraz because it was a good word, isn't it? Wonderful to see Francis at this particular time with armies of young people running around the room with huge chalices. But anyway, our brother Francis, of course, had Vatican City to worry about, and he went with a little room to worry about, even though he wants to keep it nice and sweet and clean and happy. Let us take a few moments of peace to remember that, you know, good things in life are before us, and we have been blessed in so many ways. With friends, with family, with careers, with dreams, with ambitions. Let's just take a few minutes to remember the sustenance of the creative powers. Now the second piece of music.
Just a perfect day. drank sangria in the park, and then later, when it gets dark, we go home. Just a perfect day. Feed animals in the zoo. Then later, a movie too, and then home. Just a perfect day. You made me forget myself. I thought I was someone else, someone good.
Dear friends, please bow your heads for prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We have celebrated a feast together. We have enjoyed each other's company. Let us remember in the weeks ahead until we meet again that this is increasingly becoming a spiritual home to all of us, and who knows how we can explore it in the months ahead, maybe the years ahead. Dear friends, the Lord bless you and watch over us. The Lord make his face to shine upon us. Be gracious to us. The Lord look kindly on us and give each one of us peace. Amen. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Our service of communion and remembrance is finished. Please go in peace to love and serve the world with love and wisdom. In the name of God, Amen. And thank you all for coming.